Most likely airing June 14th, 1989, here's Harold Ramis being interviewed on Later by Bob Costas.
Well, everyone sort of finds a place on the stage and a range of characters that they play, and I'd always played long-haired, freaked-out zanies. And I had a place on stage, you know, about 11 o'clock upstage, which was my sort of power spot on the stage. And when I came back to Second City, I came out to make an entrance from the wings, and there's John Belushi standing in my spot, you know, with long hair, freaked out, playing all the zanies. So in a way, he just sort of, he really took my place in that respect, and I sort of fell more into the professorial roles that I started doing after that.
In fact, they used to call you the professor. Yeah,
whenever, we do an improv that had a gang, you know, we did a lot of gangs, you know, pulling off capers. I was always Doc, the professor, or Specs, you know, that was the role I always had.
To illustrate your obtuse sense of humor, let me throw out a movie and you tell me what your personal favorite scene in that movie might be. It might not have been what made the audience laugh the most.
Favorite thing. Caddyshack, I love Bill's Dalai Lama speech. He makes it, he's talking to a young caddy about the time he caddied for the Dalai Lama in the Himalayas. I love him caddying for Henry Wilcox and the old bishop in a thunderstorm. Uh-huh. Rain is pouring down. We're using like six rainbirds and wind machines. And Bill's saying, I'd keep playing. I don't think the heavy stuff's going to come down for quite some time. And there's a lot of good stuff in there. And Bill, another Bill thing, cutting the heads off flowers with a grass whip, pretending he's in the Masters and talking to himself.
How about Stripes?
Stripes, geez, a lot of good stuff in Stripes. I like Bill's speech to rally us when he talks about that we're Americans, you know, we've been kicking ass for 200 years, we're 10-1, he says.
And, Vietnam, the only blemish on the record,
yeah,
but still leading the league.
Yeah, he says we're mutts, you know, how many saw Old Yeller, that we call it the Old Yeller speech. That's just
when he had PJ Souls on the griddle.
Yeah, you liked that.
I liked it. He was kind of moving her around with a spatula from burner to burner.
Yeah, there's a lot of improv in that film. So some of the scenes, when I watch movies that I've worked on, I'm just amazed at how much of it was discovered on the set, and how insane we were to take that chance to go in with, you know, half finished material and then finish it as we were shooting it.
Do you think that people who are pretty bright, pretty well educated, have even more of an affinity for sophomoric slapstick stuff than others do? I find you get a bunch of guys together from Harvard, and they probably like the Three Stooges.
Yeah, no, I think that's true. Critics don't, because they're not allowed to like dumb comedy. And then the more distinguished the publication, the less they're allowed to like it. Vincent Canby is always trashing the films we do in the New York Times. But there's a subtle difference, which a friend of mine once pointed out, between goofy and stupid. And there's a lot of broad comedy that's really dumb. I mean, just too dumb for me. I can't watch it. It assumes nothing on it assumes the audience are idiots. The characters in the film are idiots. I like to think that we do broad comedy that's goofy, and our characters are smart. We were told at Second City, always play from the top of your intelligence. So it's sort of a rule that I've always followed. Even if you're playing an idiot, the idiot can know a lot of things. So we try to use what we know. Bill's character in Caddyshack's a good example. This guy's obviously really off in some sense. He's disturbed, probably brain damaged. But he's tremendously clever and verbal. And
so you want a guy with no common sense, but a wide frame of reference.
Right, that's good. That's my ideal. So I think our films are not dumb. You know, they're broad, and they're crazy, but they're not necessarily dumb. So.
With Ghostbusters 2.
We pick up 5 years later, as in real life, and we're actually down and out, the Ghostbusters. We ended up paying the price for destroying that nice building on Central Park West, and Billy is doing a late-night TV show, a cable access show called World of the Psychic. Aykroyd has a bookstore called Ray's Occult Books, and he moonlights doing Ghostbuster-themed birthday parties for kids. And I'm back teaching at Columbia doing research.
Whatever this stuff is, it responds to human emotional states. Mood slime.
Oh, baby. You mean this stuff actually feeds on bad vibes?
Like a cop in a donut factory.
We've been running tests to see if we can get an equally strong positive reaction.
What kind of test?
Well, we sing to it, and we talk to it, and say supportive, nurturing things to it.
You're not sleeping with it, are you, Ray? Oh, you. It's always the quiet ones.
You hound.
How about the kinetic test? We played with every permutation of it. You know, we had a draft where we were very successful. We had a high-rise office building, the Ghostbusters Incorporated, a worldwide franchise. We had one where a draft that picked up the literally at the end of the first movie as we were driving away. And then we thought, well, let's give us something to fight against, you know, give us a goal, you know, getting back in business. In fact, in this movie, we're under a judicial restraining order not to perform services as paranormal eliminators.
Sigourney Weaver show up in this?
Sigourney's in it. In the time between the first movie and the second, her character and Bill's character had an unsuccessful relationship. They broke up, she married someone else, had a kid, got divorced, and now he comes back into her life.
So there's a real integrity to this. I mean, these people's lives are traced, they're not just thrown back together willy-nilly.
No, that was actually a good move for us from a writing standpoint, bringing her back in as a former love interest of his.
Can a sequel to a movie that successful be as good?
Be as good as the first one? No, it'll definitely be better than Police Academy 6, I promise you.
Well, as long as you set your standards high, I think we're all reassured.
I don't know. People said, some people said the script was better. That, you know, it's having written both, you know, I don't know. I have no objectivity about it. And I think the movie is great. I guess people will like it a lot. You know, it's hard to believe they liked the first one as much as they did. So, you know, I'd rather underestimate the, you know, how well this one will do than just promise everyone it's going to be the best thing they ever saw.
I haven't mentioned Dan Aykroyd's name, and we really should, because he co-wrote the screenplay with you.
Yeah, let's mention it twice. Dan Aykroyd. We wrote both Ghostbusters together. It's his original conception. He came up with the idea of ghost exterminators in New York. As soon as I heard that, I thought this is something I really want to do. And so I've spent, you know, a couple of years with Dan hammering this stuff out.
Harold Ramis, slightly off-center, and we're all the better for it, and we'll see you later.
And now we finally catch back up to the second half of that interview with Bill Murray by Chantal on Good Morning America. This aired Friday, June 15th, 1989.
Part of her interview with Bill Murray, Chantal uncovers a side of the comedian that provides insight into the funny side we see on screen, currently in Ghostbusters 2.
He had some sort of clear liquid coming out of his mouth, too.
I bet you're a great dad. I wonder if that stems from the fact that you're such a family man. Family is very important to you, is it not?
Well, you know, I'm not going to be on the cover of Parents Magazine. I don't think they'll choose me this week. But I come from a big family to begin with. I have my own family, too. But I've always, you know, kids were inevitable. I lived with, you know, we had 9 kids and we had 3 bedrooms. So they were pretty much everywhere, stumbling over them. As my whole life, and so I never thought of them as weird or unusual. They just were always there, and lots of them. So kids don't frighten me. I don't know. I'm more terrified of being a total failure than anything else. I mean, it's the fear of failure as a parent that really is. In the Catholic Church, they used to say you could be forgiven if you really were sorry or if you had a fear of hell. You know, and I used to think, well, how second rate to have a fear of hell? Well, being a failure as a parent is a fear of hell, and it all makes perfect sense to me now. There are people that I've failed, I think, and disappointed. You know, I've disappointed some people, and that, you know, I've made some people cry, and I've made some people, you know, very unhappy. And, you know, hopefully that if you don't just block it out completely, that serves the motor to try a little harder with the next person.
It wasn't too long ago I read, and I'm so sorry because she sounded like such a wonderful lady, that you lost your mom. Emily Dickinson writes somewhere, hold your parents tenderly because without them the world is a strange and lonely place.
Well, my father died when I was 17 and my mother just died last year, so those words are, you know, you can't get anyone back that's gone. Mm-hmm. And it really is an unusual feeling, and those words are right, and everyone should listen to that. It's true that when both your parents are gone, you really have a sense of aloneness, and that is scary, really terrifying. It's like being lost.
I imagine.
As a child, you really don't have anyone to help anymore, and there's a completely different feeling. I'm a completely different person. Not completely different, but I'm a very different person, just knowing that I don't have anyone that's a touchstone like that to tell me it was good or you're bad or what to do, give me advice. It's an unusual feeling, and you really feel like you're in the current of time, you know, something takes you. We were all the family was with her when she died, too. It was an amazing moment. I wish everyone could have that experience. I don't wish being rich or famous on anyone, but if you can ever be present when, you know, your parents pass away, everyone kissed her goodbye and she took her last breath and died. You couldn't have wanted anything more for her or for yourself. And, you know, just to have those moments alone, that moment, and the peace on her face, a real mysterious thing. I mean, something you don't ever forget.
Bill Murray.